Tonight we begin our journey into Holy Week. We begin our journey into that time where we, with intense consecration and concentration, focus on the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. It's a story that we tell time and time again. I was teaching a class on preaching to some ministers who were just called, and we began talking about the struggle of preaching. And one of them said that they struggle greatly during the Easter season because they're always trying to find a new way to tell the same old story. My response to them is that you don't need to find a new way. People just need to be reminded of what happened on that three days from Friday to Sunday morning, and that is at the heart of our gospel. That's at the heart of what we believe. It's at the heart of what we preach. There's no better way to preach it than to present it dramatically with song and with dance. And so tonight we are blessed to have the coming together of some of the great worship arts of our church, our drama ministry, our liturgical dancers, as well as our Kaya praise team, and many voices who bless us in song. And so I ask that you now prepare your hearts and minds for seeking Jesus as our worship arts ministry will come to lead us. We thank God for the directors already. I want to thank God for Sister Ebony Jones. I want to thank God for Brother Carl Craigway. I want to thank God for Sister Minister Sharnika Hayes for all that they've done, as well as the over 50 volunteers who've given hours of their life to prepare to minister to you right now. So do me a favor, open your heart, open your mind, let the Holy Spirit minister to you, and do me a favor, put your hands together and welcome Seeking Jesus from our drama ministry.
From the Old Testament to the New, men have shaped the narrative for much of what we know from a biblical standpoint. The stories passed down through the generations have been recorded and documented primarily, if not singularly, from the perspective of men. This is seemingly strange because we do know that since creation, women were there. So tonight, we seek to explore a different narrative. And tonight, we seek to hear the seemingly silenced voice of the women who were there. The women who walked with, touched, saw, and spoke with Jesus. He came to them when they were sick, hurting, and in deep despair, when their prayers were for direction, protection, and compassion. God sent his son Jesus. He was the answer to all they faced. Some of them were named in the Bible and some were not. They were followers of Jesus, disciples, and yes, women who were forever changed by Jesus' presence in their lives. Hear ye now them.
Wrong. Send cleansing power from above. Unite our hearts as one. Make us vessels for the flow through of your
in the richest affair. Give ear, come to me. Hear me that your soul may live. The words of Isaiah, the food that nourishes the soul, reminds me of the first time Jesus came to dinner at our house here in Bethany. There were so many reports about his preaching, his travel all the way up to Galilee and back. Martha, I remember you thought his presence in Bethany was worthy of a grand feast. Yeah. I remember you planning and shopping while all I could think about was Jesus. The great teacher and his disciples were coming to our house.
Yes, that evening, that dinner finally came. Although, not without a lot of work, I can tell you. Me, rushing from room to room, making sure that everything was ready. Stationing Benjamin, our bondservant, at the door, ready to receive Jesus the moment he entered. Benjamin, be sure to wash his feet and those of his disciples the minute they enter the atrium. Then, out into the kitchen, seeing if the roast lamb was done, checking and testing the wine, adding just the right proportions of honey. And where, might I ask, were you all this time?
Well, I had other things to do, like making sure Lazarus could receive guests. He was rather feverish that evening, as you recall. And I was out in the garden. I left my writing tablet out there. Surely, sister, you have put all those hard feelings aside. remembering how glorious it was to have Jesus and his disciples as our guest. How great an honor.
Perhaps with his first...
Peace be with you.
Oh, I did feel overwhelmed by his presence. I mean, I scarcely even remember ushering him and his disciples out into the coolness of the garden to wait until dinner was ready. But after that...
Yes, after that, you got swallowed up, pardon the pun, in the kitchen, in the dining room, back and forth and back and forth. I could see you bustling around the outside the corner of my eyes. Began to feel a little guilty, I must confess.
You should have. I had to send poor Benjamin out there with a pitcher of cooled barley beer and a tray of sweetmeats. It should have been your job.
But I felt it was my duty to be with him and our brother too. And those words of Jesus. Oh, I hung on to everyone sitting there at the grass by his feet.
Maybe I would have liked to have listened to hear from Jesus, to hear from the teacher himself, those words of wisdom that might inspire me to greater thoughts than the kitchen. But there was so much to do.
I could sense you were getting a little frustrated, but I couldn't seem able to leave Jesus to help you.
Frustrated is hardly the word, sister. I just couldn't help myself. I mean, looking in on the men, in between trips back and forth and back and forth, hoping they were enjoying the meal, hoping Lazarus was up to it. And then, wait a minute. Where, might I ask, were you all this time?
Oh, you know, I wasn't far off, standing behind Jesus, hoping to overhear what he was trying to say. A pity women weren't allowed at the meal. I might have learned more. And as it was, I had to listen to your complaints. Why couldn't you have helped me earlier? You once hissed in my ear when you passed by.
I feel bad about that now. I guess I just, I don't know. My anger rises a lot. And before I knew it, I just yelled out, "Lord! Don't you see that my sister has left me to do the work by myself? Tell her to help me!"
I remember so well the hush that fell over the dining room. The men stopped eating. Even poor old Benjamin stood there holding a large platter of honey cakes in midair. Shocking that anyone, especially the mistress of the house, would approach Jesus so directly with such a complaint.
I regretted my words the minute they came out. My knees went weak. I was afraid of what Jesus might say.
Oh, and his words were so strange, yet so comforting to me. I remember him looking at me first, and then you, and in his gentle voice.
Martha, Martha, you are worried and upset about many things, but only one thing is needed. Mary has chosen to do what is better, and it will not be taken away from her.
Yes, the very words. You didn't say much until we left the room. And then, out in the atrium, you smiled and whispered.
Yes, I remembered. I whispered, "You see? There it is, just like the words of Isaiah. The word of our Lord is like food. Don't you see it? It is the food food that nourishes the soul.
Okay, I see that now. I only wish that I could have seen it when we had to bury Lazarus. But instead, I let my temper get the best of me again.
We both were so grief-stricken. Even I lost control of myself. My emotions were all mixed up. I mean, here was the man whose very words inspired me. Here was the man I expected to heal our brother, and now this man had come too late. And when I saw Jesus come through Bethany's west gate, I, like you, I ran up and I knelt before him. Lord, I blurted out, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. There is no way we could have ever expected what Jesus would do next.
Yes. And when he said,
I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
There's no way we could have ever known. And when I saw him weep for Lazarus.
Think, Martha, what we witnessed that day. He rose our dear brother from the dead, a power greater than any king or any ruler of this world ever shall be.
Remember when I first laid with a man. I've lived in sin so long. Is beauty a sin? My mother thought so. Maybe I wasn't worth what she sold me for. It was impossible to forgive her. Money eventually came to me from my body. Perfumes, oils, a villa in Nain to buy respectability, to help me forget. Not long ago, rumors floated around town about a man preaching forgiveness. I was interested. This man was called Jesus. Some people claimed he was the Messiah. Others spoke of miracles. All this was hard to believe. Then, report came closer to home.
You would never believe what happened right here in Nineveh. Jesus actually brought a dead man back to life.
Then the impossible happened. I started to pray. I prayed. For the first time in my life, I prayed that Jesus would untie this heart knot, binding my heart ever since my mother first sold me to a man. One day, in the marketplace, I overheard several men discussing Jesus. One was obviously a Pharisee, oozing with authority. I wasn't sure about the other man, although he looked wealthy enough to be a tax collector. In my business, understandably, I'd become a fairly good judge of whatever wealth and status a man might have. As soon as I heard the word,
Jesus,
I edged closer while pretending to examine some melons, and I overheard the Pharisee say,
"We will see about this Jesus person. See if he is really a fraud or not." The real test will be whether he is actually the prophet he claims to be. I sincerely doubt that.
And pray, Simon, just how do you intend to do that?
Well, you know how he is always criticizing us, both Pharisees and Sadducees alike. That John they call the Baptist, whom he associates with. You know, that weird fellow who refers to us as a brood of vipers, who is always trying to challenge us, to undermine our authority. If Jesus finds us as bad as John claims, then we will see if he is willing to associate with us.
But how?
I plan on having a dinner at my place and invite a few more of John's so-called vipers.
It sounded like a trap. My heart sunk. What can I do about it? The morning after the next Sabbath, the answer came. A voice seemed to say,
"You are among the least of these. Yet, if you believe in me, you are truly of the kingdom of God."
I had to let Jesus know of my belief in him. And I remember the Pharisees' planned dinner. It wasn't hard to find out where Simon the Pharisees lived. I slipped through the dark streets, wrapped in a large cloak, and in my basket, I carried a jar of ointment, a special mixture of spikenard and resin. And I could smell its pungent fragrance because some of it had oozed out over the edge of the wax seal. A special mixture of spikenard and resin, the most expensive in the merchant shop. I had to trade most of my jewelry for it. But such things no longer seemed to matter. And I was beginning to understand what did matter. There was no one at the main gate of the Pharisee's house. Seems most of the servants had gone inside to serve at the dinner or just to gawk at Jesus. So I was almost able to get to the door unnoticed. I was determined to see Jesus. And just as I made it to the door, one of the servants spotted me.
"Stop! Where are you going? No women allowed in there."
I was determined to see Jesus. I rushed past. The instant I burst into the room, all talk stopped dead. A hush, silence followed. My heart pounded violently. The room seemed to swim before my eyes. And I could barely make out the men eating Roman style, lying on couches arranged on three sides around a large square table. And several servants stood behind them, hovering with pitchers of wine, trays of food, more linen napkins. But I recognized Jesus immediately. A distinct presence, different from the others. He was given the place of honor at the center of the table, rushing to his feet. I threw myself, and on my knees, kneeling there, I was so overcome with weeping, with the joy of it, that I fumbled with the jar. And after what seemed an eternity, the plug came free. I didn't dare look up. Sensed only that he turned to look at me. His bare feet lay at the end of the couch. I tipped the jar. The ointment spilled down over them. A roar of protest rose in the room. And I kissed Jesus' feet, wet with ointment. And there was no way to dry them except with my long, unbound hair.
Pharisees grabbed me, his face distorted with anger. The servants dragged me to my feet. Still, Jesus made no move. And I saw the look of vindication in the Pharisee's face. Clearly, he was thinking, if Jesus was a prophet, he'd reject me, a sinner. Instead, Jesus spoke not to me, but to the Pharisee.
Simon, I have something to tell you.
Simon paused, hesitated. Clearly, it was a dilemma to go against custom or to go against Jesus. Finally, he said,
"Yes, teacher."
I listened, stunned, as Jesus told the story of the two debtors.
Two men owed money to a certain money lender. One owing 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither had the money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more?
I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled.
You have judged correctly.
Then, Jesus turned to me. I felt his eyes upon me, eyes full of compassion and forgiveness.
Do you see this woman? I come into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but this woman has wet my feet with her tears and dried them with her unbound hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time that I've entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not give me any oil for my hair, but this woman has given me perfume for my feet. Therefore, her many sins are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little, loves little.
Once again, Jesus turned to me. He raised his hands and said,
"Your sins have been forgiven."
It was then that I understood about faith. I understood about forgiveness. Forgiveness is an act so great, yet an act so small that it could only depend on love. And I understood, too, the story of the two debtors. See, my sins were great. My debts were great, and my forgiveness all the greater, and I love him more. But the men at the table began to murmur amongst themselves.
How can this be?
Who is this that even forgives sins?
No doubt in my mind now about who Jesus was. Feeling shaken, yet strangely filled, whole. I started to leave, and Jesus rose his hand and spoke directly to me.
Your faith has saved you. Go in peace.
As I walked back to my villa, through the dark streets, with fragrance of nard still on my hair, as it blew free in the gentle breeze, free like my whole being. Mother, mother, I whispered into the streets of Nain. Peace be with you, mother. Peace be with you. I forgive you. I forgive you.
To begin with, I was cursed by that old peddler in Sychar's marketplace. He was a Jew, and he regarded me as one of the enemy.
You Israelite! You heretic!
I thought he was going to knock me down into a vat of pickled cucumbers.
You people never followed the real king of Judea. You went with Solomon's enemy, Jeroboam, instead of the rightful king, Rehoboam. You heretics!
It's not as though I wasn't already in trouble. My reputation around town wasn't exactly, well, I usually waited until the heat of midday to fetch my water. There wouldn't be many people around then. The fact that the well was on the main road made it even more difficult. From Gunai up north, the road led directly through my land of Samaria all the way down to Jerusalem. The problem is, the Jews had to get through our land to reach Judea in the south or Galilee in the north. Worse still, their heretic religion required them to do this at least 3 times a year. Well, that's what I learned from my husband, one of them, anyway. So, with a little nervousness, I headed out the south gate. I was used to carrying a water jar on my head, so I had a cushion of bright red cloth wrapped around it. It was also a bit of a risk, going out of the town on my own, but I had no other choice. Naturally, I heaved a sigh of relief when I saw that the road was empty, at least as far to the south as I could see, and I could see all the way to the holy mountain of Gerizim. As for the well that I was headed to, it was also considered sacred. To the east, there once stood the royal city of Shechem. And as for the well, it was where Abraham rested and where Jacob settled on his land. Forgive me for these boring details about the roads and such, but they're important to my story. They helped determine, so to speak, why I happened to be where I was, when I was where I was. As I walked towards Jacob's well, I couldn't help remembering Narboth. Narboth, we married so young, and he died so young. None of the men since then had been as handsome or as strong. But suddenly, I snapped out of my nostalgia about Narboth. A group of men were approaching, coming from Judea. They seemed to stop where the road divided and talk among themselves. Some pointed towards Sychar, others in my direction. Did they see me? What were they planning? Worse still, they were Galileans. Their special kind of headgear and the way they wore their cloaks thrown over one shoulder gave them away. But what could I do? I was defenseless, and there was no one in the fields that day, and the wheat was just beginning to sprout. Not a house anywhere near, and no one else in sight. As I watched, the men seemed to come to some sort of decision. Oh, may the Lord protect me, I whispered. Whichever Lord watches over Judea or Samaria, it makes no difference. Protection is all I ask. With great relief, they headed up the road, headed towards Sychar. It seemed safe enough now. But then I saw him sitting in the shade beside the well. He rose to his feet as I approached. Should I continue or drop my water jar and run back to Sychar? But something held me there. Something about his appearance. Oh, tall, bearded, dressed like most Galileans, a tan wool tunic, drawn loosely in by a tunic. Oh, a bright red cloak thrown loosely over one shoulder. Woolen locks shading most of his face from the hot sun, but something seemed different. I could see that he was looking at me closely, eyeing my water jar. I didn't expect what he said.
Will you pour me a drink?
I was completely taken aback. This from a Galilean? My mind shaped words, but my mouth couldn't say them. And in a kind of daze, I set my water jar on the ground next to the well and almost out of force of habit, began to hook the handle of a leather bucket to the chain. One would crank it down into the well far below to reach the water, and then my words came out. How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria? His reply, I didn't understand, not until afterwards.
If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked, and he would have given you living water.
Living water? Well, what does that mean? And who was this stranger who spoke in such riddles? At first, I assumed that maybe he was offering to draw water from the well himself. So I said, sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep, so how are you going to get this living water? So I set my water jar on the stone edge of the well, assuming that the stranger was asking to use it. But when he remained silent, I gathered the courage to question him further. Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his flocks and his herds? The man again looked deeply into my eyes and explained.
Whoever drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water I give them will never thirst. For the water I give them will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life.
How wonderful, I thought. Never again to have to go out from Sychar to draw water. Sir, give me this water so that I won't be thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water. But to my disappointment, he replied,
go, call your husband and come back.
Such a strange request. I had to correct him. I have no husband.
You are right when you say, I have no husband. And in fact, you have had five husbands. The man you are with right now is not your husband, which you have said is quite true.
I was stunned. How could he have known this? Yes, it was true. No husband now, after Narboth, four more, but they're all dead of disease or injuries, and the last one vanished and assumed lost, and now there I'm with old Manasseh the tanner. I'm with him because I have no kinsman redeemer. But marveling at his knowledge and suspecting that he had some sort of special power, maybe he was a rabbi among the Jews or something more, I said, sir, I see you are a prophet. I then pointed to Mount Gerizim. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place we must worship is somewhere in Jerusalem. No way was I prepared for his answer.
Woman, believe me, the time is coming when you will worship this Father on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know, for we worship what we do know. Salvation is from the Jews. Yet the time is coming, has now come, when the true worshipers must worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For those are the kinds of worshipers that the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his true worshipers must worship in spirit and in truth.
Well, I knew that even the Samaritans believed in the Messiah. So I said, yes, I know the Messiah is coming. And when he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then, in a calm, clear voice, he stated simply,
I who speak to you is he.
Was this possible? Truly, this man was no simple Galilean. His knowledge of my life, his special presence, his words. He had asked of me a drink, but he spoke of it as living water. He said that it was living water because it led to eternal life. I thought, he must be talking about a time coming soon, a time of salvation, a time when true worshipers will no longer worship here on Mount Gerizim or even in Jerusalem, but will worship the Father in spirit. But even more amazing was the fact that he called himself the Messiah.
You go downstairs and get your blood.
Okay, so turn one way.
Mm-hmm.
your water jar to feed. Just trying to satisfy the grieving. Just trying to satisfy your daily needing. Stranger at the well, with water in himself, draws near to you with love and offers life you know nothing of. Still you hear, then believe, quench your thirst at his feet. He'll be coming to the woman at the well. Women at the well knew more than tongue could tell, held fast to what he said, saw sons and daughters raised from the dead, choosing life, teaching faith, magnified by his grace. Heaven's highest praise is women at the well. Our Father gave to us the living well, with water sent to strengthen, cleanse, and heal. Come, women, to the well. Drink deep and get your fill. And then, with cup overflowing, take Jesus' hand and help him do his holy. Come to him and believe, quench your thirst at his feet. There is more than tongue can tell. Let's fill the fountain within ourselves till the women live as women at the
People often ask. I was born in a little town called Magdala on Galilee's western shore. My father said that Hebrew name was Migdal, meaning the watchtower, the one by our market guided fishing boats into the harbor. Growing up in Magdala was not pleasant. People laughed at me because of my fits. They thought I was possessed by the devil. And so, because I avoided people, they thought I was a prostitute. Not that I wasn't attractive enough. Oh, yes, then came Jesus. Not to Magdala, but to nearby Capernaum. I'd heard of his healing powers, and I went with great hope. And after a prayer to God, he looked into my eyes and laid his hands upon my head. Oh, I was never the same after that. I became one of his followers, one of his disciples, and remained with him until the end and beyond the end. Oh, I traveled with Jesus from one end of Judea to the other. Several times he invited me, to talk with him. Oh, and I learned much, sitting there alone at his feet well into the evening. Oh, those times, they were so precious to me. Oh, I was truly blessed. Well, those times began to change. A whole series of strange events once we reached Jerusalem. When Jesus entered the city on a donkey that the disciples found somewhere, the crowd seemed to grow larger and larger around him. I wasn't quite prepared to see them wave palm branches and greet him as king. I was so excited. I thought, at last, my Lord is being recognized as the Messiah. I realized it was truly a fulfillment of that old prophecy. Makes you wonder why everyone wasn't convinced that Jesus was truly the king, the Messiah, come to save them. Well, it wasn't that simple. There were traditions and politics, and a lot was going on, and the Passover meal to come. Oh, I certainly won't forget that Passover meal. The mood that evening seemed so contrary to a time of thanksgiving and joy to our people's escape from slavery out of Egypt. After all, that's what the Passover meal celebrates. That supper. Too painful to even think about. I don't think we could really have known. There's no way we could have guessed what was to come. Could we? Jesus broke bread with them, shared the wine. Oh, I remember the reaction of the disciples when Jesus said to them that he would not eat with them again unless in the kingdom of God. I guess I was more puzzled than shocked. I'd heard Jesus speak of his Father's kingdom before. I think I knew what it meant. But what was shocking was to hear Jesus say that one of his disciples would soon betray him. Of course, they all protested loudly, saying that it couldn't be possible. Yes, but there's no doubt in my mind about this betrayal, especially when I saw Judas jump up and dash out of the room. Yes, things were going terribly wrong during that meal. Oh, and then Peter said he wanted to go with the Lord wherever he might go. But Jesus said,
"Where I'm going, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow me later."
And Peter swore he'd lay down his life for Jesus. So it was a shock to hear Jesus say that before the cock crowed, Peter would disown him three times. Three times! Jesus' remark about Peter following him later, I'm not at all sure what that could mean. I and the other women were glad when Jesus said that we could leave. He and the disciples had some matters to discuss. We went back to Joab's house, where we had been invited to stay. Joanna had to get back to Herod's palace before she was missed. Oh, and by that time, Mary of Nazareth, Jesus' mother, and another Mary with her husband Clopas had arrived in Jerusalem. Oh, I'd never met Mary of Nazareth before. It was a moving experience to hear her story. Somehow comforting to hear about Jesus' birth. The little boy Jesus. The little boy who taught elders in the temple. The boy who grew into his fulfillment as the Messiah. To me, especially over the next few days when those terrible things began to happen. We were confined to Joab's house,
warned to keep off the streets. And when news came that Judas had betrayed Jesus to the Pharisees, betrayed him in the garden while he prayed, I began to realize the extent of Jesus' prophecies. Many things he'd said were coming true, horribly true. Yet, there was one thing he said which seemed to give me hope. It was after he'd been talking to Peter, right before we left the upper room. He said that in his Father's house were many rooms, and he was going to his Father's house to prepare a place for us, all who believed in him. Gives me hope that I might see him again. After that supper in the upper room, Jesus went out with his disciples to an olive grove on the other side of the Kidron Valley, just east of Jerusalem. Judas burst in, leading a group of soldiers and priests, all carrying torches and weapons. When Peter tried to resist, he cut off the ear of the high priest's servant. Jesus told him to put his sword away. Jesus often drew upon the scriptures. Oh, he knew them well. Jesus refused to resist, claiming that it was just the way it was supposed to be, according to the scriptures. The trials followed. First, the house of Caiaphas, the high priest, then the Sanhedrin, the supreme council. The disciples who were there and heard what happened said that Jesus managed to turn most of their questions around. At one point, when they asked him, was he truly the Christ, he simply said,
"If I tell you, you would not believe. And if I asked you, you would not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the mighty God."
Well, the council took that as a confession. And Jesus was sent to Pontius Pilate, the Roman procurator, for judgment in the Caesarea. From there to Herod. And then, I don't need to tell you the rest of the story, but you should know that at this point, we were feeling optimistic. Hiding there in Joab's house, we were convinced that Pilate would release him.
The first part of my story is about a man named John. I'll try to be brief. I'm not as windy as some other women. With a story like mine, they'd probably go on for hours. My name's Joanna. My age, don't ask. I grew up in the city of Sepphoris, north of Nazareth. King Herod Antipas had his court there, and I was one of the handmaids to his queen. That's how I met my husband, Chusa, one of Herod's stewards. How did I come in contact with Jesus and his disciples, you ask? Through John, who later became known as John the Baptist. As Chusa's wife in King Herod's court, I witnessed an event so horrible, I'll never be able to drive it from my mind. I was there the night King Herod was tricked into beheading John the Baptist. It was a dreadful night. Yet in some ways, it was a blessing. It led me to Jesus, the man John called the Messiah, the Anointed One. Whenever I could, I'd slip out of the palace on some pretext or other, just so I could hear him. Herod and his court traveled from one end of Galilee to the other, often even to Jerusalem, and Jesus and his disciples traveled too, so our paths often cross. On one occasion, I witnessed an event which was to affect the rest of my life. On the seashore near Capernaum, there was this woman everyone thought possessed by demons. Amidst a huge crowd, Jesus laid his hands on her and cast them out, totally changed her in an instant. That's when I first met Mary Magdalene. Little did we know, our separate paths would eventually come together. Now back to Herod. Not long after he had John executed. He found himself becoming more and more nervous about Jesus' preachings and his deeds of power. In fact, on his next state visit to Jerusalem, he found himself having to deal with the man. Jesus had been arrested and condemned by the Sanhedrin. Next, he was sent to Pontius Pilate, the Roman procurator. But because Jesus was Galilean and under Herod's jurisdiction, he had to send him back to Herod for a second trial. I remember seeing Jesus arrive under guard to Herod's palace, accompanied by a large group of chief priests and scribes. Chusa and I were in the throne room of the great hall when Jesus was made to stand before the king. Herod had summoned us, along with everyone else in the palace, to bear witness. At first, he didn't seem to know what to do. Herod was obviously stalling from time, thinking up one legal requirement after another. He wanted Jesus to perform some miracle, some trick, at least some sign to prove that he was the Son of God, as he claimed. But Jesus refused. Finally, Herod heard that one of the accusations was that Jesus claimed to be king of the Jews, and he naturally became incensed. Remember, the Romans had granted Herod that title. Was Jesus trying to usurp it? So what did he do? Herod made a joke of it.
King of the Jews. Where is your royal cloak? Where is your crown, almighty king?
He ordered a royal robe to be placed on him, a crown, but made of thorns.
All hail, King of the Jews.
Then sent him back to Pilate. Well, you know the story of what happened next. Pilate this time was forced to send Jesus for execution, to be hanged on a cross, the usual method for criminals. He might have released him, but for fear of pressure from the crowd. It was the feast of the Passover, and the crowd had made its choice. All of this was very upsetting to me. I felt helpless. Yet I thought I might be of some comfort to Mary Magdalene and the others whom I knew were staying in the house of a man named Joab. He'd been very supportive of Jesus and his disciples. I sent word back to Chusa that I was leaving the palace in the service of Queen Herodias. If he wanted to follow me, he was going to have to meet me at Joab's house. I gathered a few things together, like this shawl and my bracelet, and slipped out one of the small gates on the north side of the palace. I confess, I was not sorry to leave Herodias' service. I could never let her find me again. She'd have me beaten to death. And so it was, I found myself the next morning, joining the crowd on the way to Golgotha, the Hill of the Skulls, as it's called. Crucifixions usually took place there, just outside the city. I don't know how I managed to spot Mary Magdalene in the crowd, but she was just ahead of me with her arm around Jesus' mother, Mary. After I caught up with them, we had to half carry her up the hill. She was so grief-stricken. Then we watched that terrible event as one of three crosses was laid on the ground and her son was nailed to it. The royal robe Herod had given him had been stripped away, but he was still wearing that crown. Blood ran down his face. He spoke, but not to us. Some thought he was calling for Elijah, but we knew he was calling upon God, his Father. And then we watched that horrible event, compelled, as if unable to turn away.
Jesus' words, the violent storm, the earthquake, the tearing from top to bottom of the temple curtain, the expressions on the faces in the crowd, even the Roman centurion who proclaimed Jesus' innocence at the moment of his death. These were surely witnesses to the truth. We spent last night in a daze, shocked, horror-stricken, hardly believing what had happened. We cannot go to the tomb to prepare Jesus' body with ointments and linen bands. There wasn't time after they brought his body to the tomb. Today is the Sabbath, and care of the dead is forbidden. Now we must wait another long night. I wonder now if Judas will meet me here at Joab's. Something tells me he will not. Something tells me I will go on without him, joining a ministry which will not need Chusa, or me, or Mary, or the disciples. His truth will grow beyond us, beyond Judea, beyond Rome. Soon, the whole world will be filled with the grace of the Holy Spirit, a spirit I was so blessed to witness, and for all too short a time.
I know there is hatred in this city, beyond Jerusalem, throughout the whole province of Judea. Jews hate my husband, Pontius Pilate. He is the ruling Roman official, the procurator. Even here, inside the Caesarea, our well-fortified palace, I don't feel secure. Especially for Pontius. Every day I hear him ask the same question.
Will imperial power survive unrest among the Jews?
No one understands their politics, their talk about a man ordained by their God who is coming to save them from us, the Romans. So Pontius is anxious and nervous. So am I. Matters have come to a head because of that poor Jew. They call him Jesus of Nazareth. Some call him their Messiah. Rioting in connection with his trial was alarming. My husband doubled the guards all over the city, not only because of the trial. Their celebration called the Passover was going on. Huge crowds coming in from all over Judea, not to mention the ongoing conflicts with the local priests who call themselves Pharisees and Sadducees. Pontius said they're afraid of a Messiah's power to overthrow them. Well, certainly it all started when that man, Jesus, was arrested. Not by us, of course. By the elders and the priests of the Jewish council under the orders of the chief priest, Caiaphas. Apparently, they condemned him of blasphemy against their God, and among those people, it's considered punishable by death. There had to be a trial. First by the Sanhedrin, then by civil authority. That meant Rome, my husband, as procurator. So they brought him here to the Caesarea. Not the great council chamber, mind you, no. The courtyard was the only place big enough to hold all those priests and all those crowds of Jews. Besides, the Jews during the Passover couldn't come inside the chamber for risk of defilement. How many strange laws they have! Well, it's precisely because of that I was even more afraid for my husband. Threats against him, and perhaps assassination. Oh, and those dark shadows in my dreams kept repeating themselves. And everyone knows dreams are messages from the gods. But my dreams seem related to this man, Jesus. Once the trial began in the courtyard, I had to warn Pontius. Yet, as a woman, even as the procurator's wife, I couldn't attend the trial. How to reach him? He'd be sitting in the judgment seat on the stone steps of the council chamber rather than inside. Fortunately, I remember those secret passageways throughout the Caesarea. They go from the procurator's private apartments to other parts of the palace. I quickly took up a wax tablet and a stylus, and I wrote, "Don't have anything to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal in a dream because of him." Taking the tablet, I raced through the passageway, coming out just behind one of the courtyard pillars. The place was packed with men shouting and raising their fists. I saw Jesus in a small cleared space. He stood tall. He was stripped to his waist and bound. Obviously, he'd been beaten, for his back was bloody. Oh, the sight of the blood, the noise and confusion, that feeling of fear nauseated me.
Silence! Silence in the name of the Emperor!
The centurion commanded. It seemed a while before the crowd quieted down just enough for Pontius to be heard.
Are you the King of the Jews?
Yes, it is as you say.
A restless murmur ran through the crowd. Then Pontius had all the charges against him read out. The man answered to none of them. My husband looked taken back.
Don't you hear the charges that they're bringing against you?
Still, the man remained silent. Even I know that unless the man defended himself, he must be condemned. The law for Judea as well as Rome. On the other hand, perhaps the man was being clever by not allowing himself to be trapped. A strange man, an extraordinary man. There was something about him, a kind of distance, an unworldliness. I realize how serious my husband's situation was. I understood that there were two sources of power in conflict. Oh, I had to warn Pontius immediately in order to keep him from being victimized, but how? Rush up and shout, "Stop! Stop, husband! Think about what you're doing!" One of the centurion's guards was standing just on the other side of my pillar. I tugged on his red cloak, and he turned around.
My lady, you shouldn't be—
Silence! Face the other way. I have a commission for you. The man was puzzled, and he whispered,
"How am I supposed to get through this crowd, my lady? I cannot leave my
I am pulse. Ordering you. Take this wax tablet to the procurator. Tell him his wife sent it. Tell him to read it before it is too late." He nodded and turned away. I held my breath as I watched the plume of the guard bobbing above the crowd. It stopped before Pontius. Then Pontius, in surprise, looked up and stared in my direction. Surely he'd understand my message. Any Roman was aware of the power of dreams. Then I watched the plume of the guard heading back to his post by the pillar beside me. Watching anxiously, I saw one of the chief priests. Standing there, he faced the crowd and he shouted,
"It is still the feast of the Passover, is it not?"
Yes.
And at Passover, we still have the right to have one prisoner released, do we not?
Yes.
Yes.
There is another man. Another man being tried here. Is there not a man, a criminal named Barabbas?
That is correct.
Pontius confirmed. A hush fell over the crowd. And during that moment, I knew my husband was making a decision. Which he raised his hands for silence and said,
"Which of these men would you have me release to you? Barabbas or Jesus, who is called Christ?"
Oh, Pontius, I thought, how wise to give them a choice. They'll choose the criminal. The man Jesus will go free. But it did not happen that way. I was stunned to hear the crowd shout,
"Barabbas! Barabbas!
Let him be crucified!"
Why? What crime has he committed?
"Let him be crucified!"
I felt sickened. It did not go as I had expected, nor as Pontius expected. But would he still heed my warning? Then he called for a basin of water. I knew then what he had intended, the ritual of washing hands. And in a loud voice, he said,
"I am innocent of this man's blood. The responsibility is yours."
The crowd began to murmur and complain. "Now the blood of this man will be upon them and their children." Then Pontius ordered the guards to take the man inside and prepare him for his execution. Oh, I shuddered at what this meant. A horrible death by crucifixion, our imperial custom. I returned to our private apartments through the secret passageway. After what I had seen, I wondered whether my husband did the right thing. Would it have mattered otherwise? Could Pontius have acted against their laws? So now these days, we live in fear. Fear of riots. Fear that the emperor will hold Pontius responsible. Fear that Pontius himself would someday be put to death. Surely, the memory of that man, Jesus, whoever he was, would bring about many changes. Perhaps even the end of Rome. Although he was crucified and buried, he will not be forgotten. He will not be forgotten by me.
Jerusalem, on a dusty road, an innocent man condemned to death bore a cross on his shoulders. They didn't know. Down the Via knee as he looked upon the hatred in the eyes of his foe. Seed they didn't know. They didn't know he was enduring this for them, so they could live forevermore in paradise with him. They didn't know when they'd sing his praise with fear and trembling.
Die.
By early evening, we were allowed to take Jesus' body from the cross. Someone had a grave cloth, a long piece of fine linen. Several disciples used it to lower Jesus' body and then to wrap it for a bier. We followed through the streets with little idea of where we were going. We were still in shock, not capable of knowing much of anything. To our surprise, we learned that a rich man named Joseph of Arimathea had gone to Pilate to ask him for Jesus' body, even though Pilate made sure Jesus was dead before he granted the request. This Joseph had earlier become a follower of Jesus, even though he was a member of the council. Why hadn't he spoken up in Jesus' defense? The thought of it made me so angry. It might have made a difference. At least his offer now made a difference. Joseph, with us and several of the disciples, took the bier to a garden on a hillside used for burial. It appeared that Joseph had recently commissioned a tomb in preparation for his own death. He'd offered it on a temporary basis because Jesus' body had to be placed somewhere quickly. It was nearly the Sabbath. No burials could take place during those hours under Jewish law. The problem was, however, we weren't able to finish preparing the body with spices and herbs until the Sabbath was over. So Joseph, wanting to keep the body safe, ordered that the tomb be sealed with a big rock. And then we all returned to Joab's house. It was an agonizing time that Sabbath. We could hardly wait for it to be over so we could return to the tomb and perform the necessary rites. The body of our Jesus must be prepared with our loving care and tears. At last, the next day, it was early, still dark, with a few people about. The other Marys and I, with Joanna, hurried through the nearly empty streets. Entering the garden, we looked for the tomb. It was getting lighter, but we still weren't quite sure which one it was. I got separated from the others and found myself wandering alone amongst the tombs. Being alone was worrisome because I knew that that stone sealing Joseph's tomb was too heavy for one person, for one woman, to move. Suddenly, there it was. No, it couldn't be. A tomb with a stone rolled back. Oh, it's been here already, I cried. Someone up to no good, stealing Jesus' body to prove that he would not rise from the dead. So I rushed into the tomb. It felt cool and damp. No sign of the body. The stone slab was empty. Only the grave cloth was left, that still lay like the body it once covered. Strange. The headcloth had been left neatly folded. Grave robbers. It had to be grave robbers. But why would they leave that linen cloth as valuable as it was? Suddenly, a bright light blinded me. I dropped the tray of ointments I was carrying. I remember hearing the glass vials shattering and the oil spreading over my feet. The light seemed to be coming from two radiant figures, so wrapped in their own light that I couldn't make them out. One sat where Jesus' head had lain, the other where his feet had been.
Woman, why are you weeping?
How can I explain? I blurted out, they have taken my Lord away, and I don't know where they have put him. At that moment, I sensed someone at the entrance of the tomb. I thought it might have been the other women or someone I could ask about Jesus' body. I turned to see a man standing there. His face was concealed. The man repeated what those radiant figures had asked.
Woman,
Why are you weeping? Who is it that you're looking for?
I thought he might have been one of the gardeners, so I said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will go get him." That moment, the man looked into my face as he had looked into my face during that moment of healing in Capernaum.
Mary?
He called me by my name. A shudder went through my body, a tingling sensation down my spine. It was Jesus, oh, Rabboni teacher. I fell at his feet, and I seized the edge of his robe, but Jesus drew back and said,
"Do not hold on to me, for yet I have not returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them that I am going to return to my Father, to your Father, to my God, and your God."
I didn't wait. I rushed blindly down the path. I ran headlong into the other women. There was no time to explain. I ran all the way through the streets, running this way and that way, until I finally made it to the place where Peter and the others were staying. Out of breath, I told them what I had seen and I had heard. It took some convincing, but they came to see that I spoke the truth. Well, all except Thomas. Thomas had to see for himself. Thomas actually touched the nail-scarred hands of Jesus. And like me, he was never the same.
Then I was told that Pilate tried to question him. And Pilate didn't understand what my son was saying. But I think that I would have understood when my son said that his kingdom was not of this world. I think that I would have understood when my son said that he had come to testify to the truth of the kingdom of God. But there were so many things that I didn't understand. I didn't understand why my son didn't stand up for himself. He was not a traitor. He had not committed blasphemy. His disciples knew that. They and many in the crowd were convinced that he was the Messiah and that he could save himself. But my son simply did what God, his father, had ordained. From the trials to the cross, my son was going to be crucified. I walk those narrow streets of Jerusalem with some of the disciples toward the hill. I'll never forget the terrible scraping sound that the cross made on the stone pavement. The great roar of noise from the crowd. They were treating my son like a common criminal. He was about to be put to death. The world started to swim around me, and I felt a strong arm around me, and it was Mary Magdalene.
Courage, Mother of Mary, Mother of Jesus. May the Lord be with you during this difficult time.
Oh, and then on her other side was Joanna and the other Mary and some of the disciples. And my own tears came the moment that I heard them pounding the nails into my son's hands and feet. I wanted to put my hands over my ears, but I knew that it would do no good. So I stood at the foot of that cross, and I watched my son die little by little. It was unbearable. I wanted to die with him. His disciple John was there. And he looked down at both of us and he said,
"Dear woman, here is your son."
And then he looked at John and he said,
"And here is your mother."
And then my son, my Jesus, died. I can't help but weep now. Those terrible moments will never leave my heart. Oh, look, it's getting dark. And I must prepare to put this cloth away. But even as I prepare to put it away, I can feel his presence still.
But the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid. You have heard me say, I am coming back. If you love me, you will be glad that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. I have told you now before it happens, so when it does happen, you will believe. I will not say much more to you, for the prince of this world is coming. He has no hold over me. but he comes so that the world may learn that I love the Father and do exactly as my Father has commanded me. Come now, let us leave.
This is but an earthly grave cloth that held an earthly body in a tomb. It is now empty as the tomb is empty. But it's a reminder of everlasting life and what Mary Magdalene witnessed. I guess I should eat something before I go to bed. I can see the girl Sarah has left supper on the table for me the way she does every night. But it's earthly food. And I know the moment will come when I shall no longer need it. I know the moment shall come when I shall see my son again. The moment of his return. I await the day when Jesus Christ shall return for all of us.
Sky shall unfold, preparing his entrance, and the stars shall applaud him with thunders of praise. Sweet light in his eyes shall enhance those awaiting. Yeah, we shall behold him, then face to face. We shall behold him, yes, we shall behold him face to face in all of his glory. We shall behold. Then we shall behold him.
Mm-hmm.